Okay. So how's everybody doing today? Good. Glad to see you guys. Always happy to see you guys. So, thank you, Al. Thank you. All right. So we're going to do something a little different. Sometimes I take you guys through my process of how I study the Bible and how I get the most out of it. And this is going to be one of those days. So y'all with me? Y'all going to take that journey with me? Okay. All right. So it is. Good morning, brother. Oh, you're good. Yeah. Hop right in. You're fine. All right. So today is Baptism Saturday. Last Saturday of every month, we do baptism out here. And I know there's a few people getting baptized today. And I hope if you were moved today, that you'll join us in that, right? Because that's what we're going to talk about today. I had something else planned. Doesn't matter. We'll do it next week. And I love it. I hope you guys are here next week because it's an awesome message. It just, the more I prayed about it, it wasn't for today, right? So I've gone to church for a long time. 35 years. I didn't grow up in church, but whenever I was 18 years old, my world was falling apart, and I was, doing drugs and all that. And I started going to church. So I've been in and out of churches for a long time, 35 plus years, right? And I've never heard anybody actually do a message on baptism. People will talk about it when, like right before they give you a little class on it or whatever. So it was just on my heart to really talk about, from a biblical standpoint, what it is. Because I think we've got an idea of what baptism is and what it means. But I don't know if we really know what the Bible says about it. Is that, y'all with me on that? Okay. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Y'all okay with that? All right. Who's excited about it? All right. Have to work the crowd. All right. So, twofold. I'll show you how one of the ways that I study the Bible, and hopefully through showing you that, we learn a lot about baptism and get a good picture of it. So, we can never build a doctrine being what does the Bible say, and what's our theology, our belief system. That's what doctrine is. We can never build a doctrine in the Bible around a singular verse, right? That's where people get in trouble, and that's why we've got so many different denominations, okay? So if we want to build sound doctrine, which is what the Bible tells us we need to follow, if we want sound doctrine, then we need to know everything the Bible says about a subject, right? To be able to get a clear picture of what that is. So this is going to be simple today, guys. I'm not going to give you my opinion on baptism. What I did is I spent a lot of time yesterday once God has spoken to me and I decided on this is the path we were going to go. I spent a lot of time yesterday finding every verse that talks about baptism in the New Testament. Every single verse. Okay? And I went back through and I put those in chronological order, meaning the way that they were spoken and the way that this came down. And so all we're going to do here today, I'm going to throw in a little bit of my opinion on it, maybe a little bit of explanation, but it don't take much from me. And it shouldn't be coming from me anyway, okay? It should be coming from what God says about it, okay? So the main thing we're going to do today is just go through and read these verses. And then we're going to form from that what our belief system is about what baptism is. Amen? And I want to hear from you, okay? I don't want you to preach or let's go off and get on a different subject, right? But because that job's taken. So, but I do want to hear from you. Once we read through a section of this that's talking about baptism, I want to hear what you're hearing. Okay? Is that fair, Christy? So I'll read through these parts of it, and then you tell me, what does it mean? What's the Bible saying? Because I think it's pretty clear. Okay? Now, I want to be clear when I start off here. Baptism doesn't save you. The blood of Jesus Christ saves you. Faith in the sacrifice that he made on the cross is what redeems us and brings us back to the Father, right? That's our salvation, right? And the Bible is very clear on that. It is by faith alone. Guys, where's all my fellas at? Amen. Can we get some help with some prayer up here from our okay. All right. Is it okay? It's okay? Okay. All right. So, and let's just pray real quick. Let's pray for peace and clarity and that the enemy is not able to rob us of what God wants to do today. Amen? Amen? It's fine, Mark. It's fine, brother. All right. Father, we thank you so much for the peace and the joy that you give us every day. We ask you to just open your word to us, continue to show us your presence, manifest yourself. Lord, surround us with your goodness, surround us with your glory. Take away anything, any distraction that might take away from what you have for us today. And we pray it and claim it in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Okay, so the Bible is consistent. The Bible is consistent. 66 books written by 40 different authors over 2,500 years. It sings the same song all the way through, right? And again, that's why we can't take a singular verse out of context and build a doctrine around it. Because the Bible is going to tell us and show us the same thing all the way through. So, do we have pictures of baptism in the Old Testament before Jesus went to the cross? Anybody? Yes? Any examples that y'all can think of pictures of baptism in the Old Testament? Things where God was showing us what baptism meant? Okay, I'll give you. That's a good one, Celeste. Yeah, that's thinking deep, right? So we had this general from, I believe, from the Hittite army. He's either Hittite or Moabite army. His name was Ammon, I believe, that had leprosy, right? And so he was prayed for, and he went and washed in the Jordan, went and washed in the water, and it was cleaned up. I think Celeste is looking it up there. So yeah, that's a picture of baptism. I'm going to give us the two biggest examples and the ones that are referenced in the New Testament by New Testament authors telling us that these were pictures of baptism. Okay, the first one is Noah's flood. Y'all with me? Okay. So Noah was told by God that a flood was coming and he was to build a boat. And that when that water came in, when the floods came and the rain came, that he would be protected through that water, him and his family, and saved so to fulfill his purpose. Amen? Okay? And then the second one that's mentioned in the New Testament, talking about it being a picture of baptism, is when the Israelites went through, God separated the Red Sea and they went through the water, okay? Now, let's look at the similarities of those two things. In both Noah's flood and the separating of the Red Sea, something died. right? So everyone died in the flood except for Noah and his family to be able to go on. So that flesh was buried there. In the going through the Red Sea, the Egyptian army was covered. The enemy was covered, right? And so these are pictures of what the New Testament tells us baptism is that we're putting off our old self, we're dying to who we used to be, and we're being raised into newness of life, right? So you see how that's a picture? So the other similarities are we're making a transition from one thing to the next. We're making a transition from the old thing into a new thing, right? That God was recreating the human race through the flood, getting rid of, purging out what was evil so that it could carry on, so that he could save humanity. And in the Red Sea, when he was taking them out of Egypt, he was having them pass through that Red Sea so they could go into the Promised Land and come out of the bondage that they were in Egypt. Y'all see that, right? And that's what he wants for us too. So those are pictures of baptism, okay? There are many more in the Old Testament, and they all have those similarities, okay? So what we're going to do is we're just going to start at the beginning, and y'all, they're taking care of that, right? Here's what the enemy wants. The enemy wants you to look over there and pay attention to that and miss what he has for you here. Amen? So let's don't let him win, okay? They're loving on him. They're praying for him. They're going to see him through that. But let's don't let it rob us from what God wants us to do right here. Amen? Okay. All right. So when we get to the New Testament, the very first theme that we see, the very first thing that we're introduced to in all four Gospels is a man named John the Baptist, who we've talked about here a lot. John the Baptist. And he came out of the wilderness preaching a gospel of repentance, a message of repentance, which means turning your heart and your eyes back to God, right? It has a couple of significant meanings. One is that we change our mind about God, and the other is it's a military term. It means to turn around and go the other direction, right? So we've been going one way for all our lives. God wants us to turn around and come back to him so that he can show us a new and better path. Amen? So I'm going to read you the verses about what John the Baptist was doing. John appeared, Mark chapter 1, verses 4 and 5. John appeared baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Y'all follow me? Matthew 3:11. John told them, I baptize you with water for repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Not bad fire, good fire. Fire that purges us, fire that cleanses us. Amen? Luke 3:3, and he went into all the region around the Jordan proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Luke 3:16, John answered them all saying, I baptize you with water, but he who is mightier than I is coming, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Some of these are going to be duplicates, guys, because we got four Gospels. We got four people telling basically the same story about Jesus. Amen? Okay, so what was John's baptism about? Based on those verses, what was his baptism about? Greater ways to come? A greater one is to come? That's one. That there's a one coming after him. Margo, what was yours? Turning your hearts back to Christ. A repentance, right? And so, go ahead, brother. Preparing for prophecy, right? Yep. Prophecy being fulfilled, which is Christ is coming, right? So the two most common themes that we see in John's baptism, and what the Bible tells us about John's baptism is it was preparing us to meet Jesus, right? And how did he tell us to prepare to meet Jesus? Change your mind about God, confess your sins, turn around and come back to God. Amen? Right? So that's what John's baptism was about. And that's the first tenet of baptism, is that we're changing our mind. We're deciding we want to go a different direction. The past is the past. We want to walk a new and better way, because this way we've been going ain't working. It hasn't worked out, right? Are y'all with me on that? I know for me, man, we all just come to that point where it's like, whew, I have no idea. I don't know what to do next, right? And that is the exact best place. My brother here was talking to me earlier, right? And that's where you've been, right, brother? It's like, I don't know where to go next. I'm helpless, you know? And we think that's weakness. We think that that's a sign of weakness. We don't want to confess that to anybody. We don't want to tell anybody that we don't know what we should do next. And Jesus says, that's exactly where you need to be. That's exactly where I want you to be. Because you were never supposed to walk this thing out by yourself. I was always, my intention was always to walk it out with you and in you. Amen? So when you get to the end of yourself and you finally realize you were never supposed to do it without me, that's where the good stuff starts. Amen? So that's repentance. We're saying, I don't know. And he's not saying you got to clean up to come to me. He's saying, come to me so we can clean you up. Amen? Right? And that's a process. Right? Okay. Amen. All right. So John 1:29 through 33. The next day he saw Jesus coming towards him. This is John the Baptist. And said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. This is he whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks before me. Because he was before me. Because he's God. Amen. I myself did not know him, but for this purpose, I came baptizing with water, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John bore witness, I saw the Spirit descend from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he who you see the Spirit descend and remain, this is he who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven saying, you are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Amen? Amen. Luke 3, 21 and 22. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heavens were opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, you are my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Matthew 3, 13 to 17. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you. So John said, whoa, you're the Lamb of God. I can't baptize you. I need you to baptize me. And Jesus answered him and said, let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented, John consented, and when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him, and behold, a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Amen? All right. So, did Jesus need to be baptized? No, he's God, right? And John knew Jesus didn't need to be baptized, and he didn't think he was worthy to baptize him. But what did Jesus say? What did Jesus come to do other than to, other than the primary thing was to save us, what did he come to do? What was his purpose on earth walking it out here? It was to be an image for us to duplicate, right? God said, I made man to be in my image, right? And so Jesus is giving us an example all the way through of the things that he wants us to do and the things that are necessary. So when Jesus said, John, you got to baptize me because that's going to fulfill all righteousness. And what does righteousness mean? I'll give you a reminder. I know we talked about it before. Righteousness means we're taking the right path, right? That we're aligning ourselves with God and we're getting in right standing with him. Amen? So Jesus said, it's necessary to do this because I want to show you, I want to give you the image and example of what you need to do to be on the right path, in the right standing, and right relationship with God. Amen? Right? So was Jesus saying baptism's pretty important? That's a weak yes. Was Jesus? Okay. All right. All right. Moving along. Again, we're going through this chronologically. We're just reading the Bible. Luke chapter 7, verses 28 and 29. He says, I tell you, among those born, this is Jesus speaking, and he's speaking about John the Baptist. He said, I tell you, among those born of women, there is no one greater than John, yet even the least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. All the people who heard this, even the tax collectors, acknowledge God's justice, that God is just, right? For they had received the baptism of John. So all the sinners had received the baptism of John. And they glorified God because they knew it was a just calling. Amen? It says, but the Pharisees and the experts in the law, the religious people that thought they had it all figured out, rejected God's purpose for themselves. They had not been baptized by John. And rejected God's purpose for themselves because they had not been baptized by John. Amen? Right? So the religious people rejected this because they think they got to figure it out. The people that know they need Jesus, that they don't have, that they've got to have a Savior, they need to be reconnected with God, those are the people that accepted it and were in full repentance moving back towards God. Amen? Matthew 21:25. The baptism, this is Jesus speaking again, and he's speaking about John, and this is after they've killed John. They cut his head off for speaking the truth. Amen? So Jesus is speaking to these lawyers, these Pharisees, these religious folks again, and he asks them, the baptism of John, where did it come from? From heaven or from man? And they discussed it among themselves, saying, if we say from heaven, he will say to us, why then did you not believe? All right? So they don't want to answer him. They don't want to answer him because they know they've killed John or they've been complicit in John's death, right? And he's asking them, was it from man or was it from God? So what's the answer to that? Was John's baptism from man or from God? From God. Amen? Right? Mark 11:30, he asks again, was the baptism of John from heaven or from man? Amen? Okay, so that covers John's baptism that was just a baptism that was of repentance, turning our hearts back, right? Preparing us to meet Jesus, okay? So we don't hear any more about baptism in the New Testament until after Jesus is arrested, beaten, crucified, buried, and resurrected from the dead 3 days later. Amen? Right? The next time that we hear about baptism is after that. Okay? After he's fulfilled all the things necessary, paid the price for us to be able to return to God. Amen? Okay. So, after the resurrection, and right before Jesus ascends into heaven, it says, Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. That means go out and tell everybody about Jesus, right? That's our job as Christians. Share the love and the grace and the mercy of Christ, right? And then he says, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Go ahead, brother. That is Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. Okay? So Jesus, we call this the Great Commission. The last thing that Jesus says before he ascends into heaven is go and make disciples of all the nations, baptize them. Amen? Enough said? Okay. In John 14:15, Jesus says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. This is Luke writing about Jesus, right? Writing about the church. He says, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he presented himself to them with many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a span of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. And while they were gathered together, he commanded them, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift the Father promised, which you have heard me discuss. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Amen? All right. Okay. This next part's a little long. Okay? We're in Acts chapter 2, and this is the start of the church on earth. Okay? This is 40 days after, or 50 days after Jesus has been crucified and resurrected. It's 10 days after he's ascended into heaven. He's told them to go back to Jerusalem and wait for the Holy Spirit to come. Okay? So I'm just going to read through this. Right? I'm not going to do it real fast, but I want you to hear everything that it's saying. It's Acts chapter 2, and we're going to do verses 1 through 8, verse 12, and then verses 36 to 42. Okay? I felt like it was too long to do the whole thing, so we're just going to hit the high points in here. But what I want us to see on this is where the church starts. And what I want us to understand is that was 2,000 years ago, but the church has not changed in 2,000 years. What God did then, he does today. The way that he operated and the way that he started the church and the way people came to Christ is the way that he operates today. Amen? All right. So it says, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. I mean, all of the believers at that time, believers in Christ, were in one place. They were in the upper room, the same upper room that he had the Last Supper with the disciples. There's 120 of them gathered in this upper room, okay? It says they were in one accord, in one place, and they were praying. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and what one sat upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this occurred, the multitude came together and were confused because everyone heard them speak in his own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, look, are not all those who speak Galileans, meaning that they were from that area, but they're all speaking our languages. We can hear them in our own language. So this is a miraculous thing that God had done to show that the Holy Spirit had come into his church and was manifesting through them. Amen? And then Peter told them about Jesus. Now that he's got everybody's attention, these 120 have been filled with the Holy Spirit. There's all these people that are there for this festival of Pentecost thousands and thousands of people from all over the world. God does this miracle through them where they're hearing the gospel in their own language. And then Peter stands up and he says, let me tell you what this is. This is a fulfillment of prophecy. This is what God has spoken about for thousands of years, that Jesus is the Messiah, that he died for our sins, and he died for our sins so that he could live inside of us, that the Holy Spirit could come into us, live in us, and we could have life in him. Amen? Right? So it says, therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Christ. Amen? Now, when they heard this, it says they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? They're asking now, how do we get saved? How do we get what you guys have got? How do we get the Holy Spirit in us? How does that work? What's our next step? Amen? And Peter's answer to them is very simple. He says, then Peter said to them, repent. We know what repentance means, right? Turn back to God. Turn away from the world, turn back to God. And let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive this same gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many words he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized. And that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and prayer. Amen? This is the first time that people were baptized. The first time that they received the Holy Spirit. Y'all follow me? Now we're going to read the rest of the accounts, because we're in the section now where we're seeing what the church believed that Jesus had taught about baptism and how baptism was performed, right? Okay? So I'm going to go through this, and then I'm going to let you guys tell me what you learned. Amen? Y'all with me? Okay. Acts 4:12. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Philip, the apostle Philip, goes to Samaria. And it says, but when they believed Philip as he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself, who was a sorcerer, was believed. And after being baptized, he continued with Philip. And seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Philip goes on, and he meets an Ethiopian eunuch on the road that's riding in a chariot that is reading Scripture but doesn't understand it. It says, then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with the Scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. And as they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized? And he commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. Amen? The next time this somebody comes to Christ that we read about in the book of Acts is the Apostle Paul, who was a persecutor of the church, who had been running down the church, arresting them, being complicit in the deaths of Christians, right? And Jesus knocked him down on the road to Damascus, revealed himself to him. He accepted Christ, and it goes like this. And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes because he had lost his sight, and he regained his sight. Then he arose and was baptized. Amen? The next time we... Go ahead, bro. That's Acts chapter 9, verse 18. Acts chapter 10, verses 44 to 48. Peter is told by God to go to a Roman centurion, a Gentile, This is something Peter's not comfortable with. He thought it was just for the Jews. He's told to go to his what is the enemy of the nation of Israel and tell him about Jesus. It says, but while Peter was still telling them about Christ, the Holy Spirit fell on all of them who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles, for they were hearing them speak in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. I'm going to keep going if nobody stops me. Acts chapter 16, verses 13 to 15. On the Sabbath, we went out. This is Paul and Luke as they're traveling and planting churches. It says, on the Sabbath, we went outside the city gate along the river, where it was customary to find a place of prayer. After sitting down, we spoke to the women who had gathered there. Among those listening was a woman named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth from the city of Thyatira, who was a worshiper of God. The Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message, and when she and her household had been baptized, she urged us, if you consider me a believer in the Lord, come stay at my house, and she persuaded us. Amen? Acts chapter 16, verse 31 to 33. Paul and Silas have been thrown in jail for preaching the gospel. And God, the Spirit of God and angels, comes into that jail and opens up all the doors and breaks all the chains off of them in the middle of the night. And the jailer comes in, and he takes out his sword, and he's going to kill himself because he knows he's in big trouble, because all the people are going to escape. And Paul says, nope, don't kill yourself. We didn't go anywhere. Jesus freed us inside the walls. We don't need to walk out. We're never a prisoner. Doesn't matter where we're at. Amen? He said, and they said, the jailer asked him, what do I need to do to be saved, right? That's a common theme too, right? When somebody sees the power of God going in on your life, they want to know how they can get that power. Amen? And they said, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house, and he took them that same hour of the night and washed their wounds, and he was baptized at once, he and his whole family. Amen? Acts chapter 18, verse 25. We meet a guy named Apollos that is zealous for God, and he's preaching the gospel, but he doesn't know everything about Jesus. He doesn't know that Jesus is the Messiah. It says he had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he spoke and taught accurately the things concerning Jesus, though he knew only the baptism of John. And so two of Paul's companions pulled him aside, told him more accurately the word of God, and he was baptized into Jesus. Amen? All right. Acts chapter 18, verse 8. The ruler of the synagogue named Crispus believed in the Lord together with his entire household, and many of the Corinthians, hearing Paul, believed and were baptized. Acts chapter 19, verse 1 through 6. And it happened that while Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the inland country and came to Ephesus. There he found some disciples, and he said to them, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they say, no, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. And he said, into what then were you baptized? And they said, into John's baptism. And Paul said to them, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen? All right. Every time in the book of Acts, I did this to demonstrate what happened every time somebody came to Jesus. You guys tell me. They're baptized immediately, right? They also receive the Holy Spirit immediately. So the pattern of this was exactly what Peter described in Acts 2:38. So we've got 12 more times in the book of Acts where people got saved, and in every occasion, three things happened. They repented, confessed their sin, turned their heart back to God. They were baptized in water. They received the Holy Spirit. Amen? Hey, and sometimes they received the Holy Spirit and then got baptized. Right? And sometimes they believed in Jesus because even before they knew who Jesus was. And then they were baptized and they got the Holy Spirit. So, but those three things, those three components are what take place. Amen? And in every one of them, you can't find a place in the first church where somebody came in and wasn't baptized. Amen? Right? So I told you before, we are saved by faith alone, but if we're just reading the Bible, it seems like this is pretty important. Amen? Would y'all agree with that? It doesn't seem like it was, well, do you want to get baptized? Do you want to take part in that? It was just, that's what happened. They taught it as if it was, this is just something, this is part of it. Amen? Right? Okay. So, what then, now that we've seen every example in of the New Testament church and what they thought about this and how they practiced it, let's also go through the motions. How were people baptized in the New Testament based on what we read there? I'm sorry? Okay, baptism in the Spirit, but on the baptism in water, how were they baptized? Amen. Both of you, down into the water, right? Into the water, not a sprinkling, not a hose, right? They're buried in the water. Okay, they're baptized in the water. I don't want to make anybody mad here. But again, we're trying to get what the Bible says about this. Do we have any evidence from what we read, and we're reading every verse that has to do with baptism, right? Is there any evidence in here of a baby getting baptized? Is there? Okay. Is there any evidence of people getting baptized that don't believe in Christ? No. Right? So, The requisite here is that we're making a conscious decision to put our faith in Christ and the sacrifice that he made, and then joining him in the death, burial, and resurrection that he had for us through baptism. Amen? And receiving his Spirit. It's the cleansing of it. Yeah, and we're about to read more about that with the apostles' teaching. But as far as the practice goes, they said there's much water here. They went down into the water. The word baptism itself means completely immersed in water. Amen? Right? Because we are taking on the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. Amen? All right. So now let's read what the apostles have to say about it. Here's what Peter says in 1 Peter 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 3:18 through 21. Christ suffered for our sins once for all time. He never sinned, but he died for sinners to bring you safely home to God. He suffered a physical death, but he was raised to life in the Spirit. So he went and preached to the spirits in prison, those who had disobeyed God long ago, when God waited patiently while Noah was building his boat. Only 8 people were saved from drowning in that terrible flood. And that water is a picture, a type of baptism, Peter says, which now saves you, not by removing dirt from your body, but as a response to God from a clean conscience. It is effective because of the resurrection of Christ. Amen? All right? Paul, in Titus chapter 3, verse 5, says he saved us not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12:13. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. Amen? So you're being baptized into Christ, but you're being baptized into a family. Amen? Ephesians 2, chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no man may boast. Ephesians 4, 5. For there is one body and one spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future. There is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, in all, and living through you all. Amen? Galatians 3, 26 and 27. I want y'all to pay attention to the rest of these, right? Only got three more, and we're going to wrap up. Galatians 26 and 27. For in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Amen? Colossians chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. When you came to Christ, you were circumcised, but not in the flesh. Christ performed a spiritual circumcision, one that's on your heart. He cut away your sinful nature, for you were buried with Christ when you were baptized. And with him, you were raised to new life because you trusted the mighty power of God, who raised Christ from the dead. You were dead because of your sins and because your sinful nature was not cut away. Then God made you alive with Christ, for he forgave all your sins. Amen? All right, last one. Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. He says, well then, should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of his wonderful grace? He said, if Jesus has forgiven us of everything, past, present, and future, should we just go on living the same way that we lived before so that God can continue to show us his wonderful grace? He said, of course not. Since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? Yeah. I was looking for my towel. It was on my shoulder. He says, of course not. Since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? Or have you forgotten that when you were joined with Christ Jesus in baptism, and just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives? Amen? Since we have been united with him in his death, we will also be raised to life as he was. We know that our old sinful selves were crucified with Christ, so that sin might lose its power in our lives. We are no longer slaves to sin, for when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. And since we died with Christ, we know we will also live with him. Amen? Amen. Look, it's clear that the apostles saw this as an act of us taking on and accepting the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, and that we're a part of that. And that this is a picture, what we do here by being buried in that water and raised into new life is a picture of that joining together with him. Would y'all agree with that? Does anybody have any questions about this? Is the Bible pretty clear on this subject? Okay. Has any... Go ahead, Raj. Huh? Oh, well, yeah. No. Okay, so Roger said, well, after baptism, we still sin, right? That's confession. So, all right. So, yes, we do because we're still trapped in this body. But we're not slaves of sin, right? We're not mastered by sin. Once we realize, and man, this is the hardest thing for us to realize as Christians, right? Once we realize that that sin doesn't keep us away from Jesus, that it doesn't separate us from God, that Jesus paid that price, that we are literally dead to that sin, okay? Oh, man, if I could get y'all to get a hold of it, if y'all could grab a hold of this with both hands, I'm telling you, it will change your life. The Bible tells us, again, in Romans, right, it tells us that you can only be held accountable for the sin in your life one time. And the payment for that sin that you've committed throughout your life, the debt that you owe for that is death. That's the penalty for the sin in your life. The penalty is death. Okay? Do y'all get that? There's no other way around it. The penalty for sin is death. Here's what Jesus did. He died. And then he said, all of you died with me. All of you who put your faith in me died with me. You came with me. You not only were joined in my death, you're joined in my resurrection. So the penalty for all that sin, all of the things that you've ever done, all of the things that you will do, has already been paid because you're dead. Do you follow me? I know that's hard for us to wrap our minds around. But we have taken on that death. We have joined him in that death. And it says through baptism, right? That we've joined him in that death. And he says that because of that, we're no longer slaves to that. And again, hard for me to get across, guys. But look, the reason that we're slaves to that sin is because we believe that there's punishment associated with it, right? That we live in fear all the time. And every time that we make a mistake and every time we fall down, we think we got to run away from God. We got to get away from him. We can't be near him, right? And he's saying to us, that's all done because that guy doesn't exist anymore. You are a new creation in Christ Jesus. I've made you brand new. You're a new thing, right? The old things have passed away. It's all brand new because that John is dead. That Robert is dead. That Al is dead, right? All you have to do is live in the freedom that you're in relationship with me, and nothing separates us. There is no separation between you and me. Hey, does anybody get that? Say it again. John 8:36, tell us what it is. Right. Whom the Son has set free is free indeed. Amen? Amen. Anybody else? Roger, does that help? Say it again, brother. Say it loud. Yeah, well, yes. He said if we sin, we need to confess it, right? And yeah, we do. Yeah, because you want to get that out of the way, right? We were talking about this in my marriage group the other night, right? We have a little marriage group that we get together, and the only power that sin has over us is when we keep it in the dark. Sin grows, destruction grows in the dark, right? If we, the Bible tells us, confess your sins one to another and pray for each other that you might be healed, right? So if John's having a problem, right, and I'm not picking on John, but if John has an issue that he's going through, something that he's struggling with, and he comes to me and we pray about that, that thing loses its power, right? So we think about the darkest, deepest sin that we've ever committed. When we know that we're in a community of love that we could trust each other, and we know that we serve a God that loves us, cherishes us, and has paid for everything, right? Then that thing loses its power. The thing that you think is most disgusting that you've ever done in your life loses its power over you once we've given it up, once we've turned it over. Now, Paul goes on in that very next chapter of Romans, in Romans 7, and he said, man, I'm wretched. He said, the things that I want to do, I don't do. Now, this is the guy that wrote two-thirds of the New Testament. This is his confession. He said, the things that I want to do, those things I don't do. And the things that I want to do, I don't do those things. I am constantly battling against this flesh because I want to be good. I want to do the right thing, and I turn right around and do the wrong thing. He said, who will save me from this body of sin and death? He said, I thank my God through Jesus Christ. It's already done. It's already paid for. It's already through. He said, all I'm looking for now, going on into chapter 8, all I'm looking for now is for him to continue to transform me into his image. For me to put off the things that I have done and the way that I thought, and that I'm going to continue to look towards him. I'm going to continue to strive after him, and he's going to continue to make me into the thing that he always intended me to be. Amen? Amen? Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Yeah, he gives us he puts a new nature inside of us, right? Look, let me tell you, we talked about this in my men's group too, right? We talked about, go ahead, sister. Sorry. I can't even hear you. Can you relay? Yes, it's a type of, she said, when you're being baptized, you're being anointed, right? And yes, it is a type of anointing, okay? One of the other symbols and pictures that we have in the Old Testament of what baptism is the laver that was set up behind the brazen altar in the temple. So they would make the priests would go in to approach God, and they would make their sacrifice on the brazen altar, and then they would go behind the brazen altar, and the next step was a big bowl where they had to wash themselves. They had cleansed themselves to go into the presence of God, and that is a type of anointing. It's a type of washing, a transition. Yes. Yeah. Anybody else on that? Seal of redemption. Yeah. Yeah, it is. I hate to use the words that I think this is more than a symbolic gesture, what we do here. Okay. I just read you every verse in the New Testament about baptism. The thing that we hear in most of our churches is that this is an outward expression of an inward feeling, right? It's an outward gesture of a thing that's happening inside of us, right? I didn't read anything that said that in the Bible, right? Jesus said, go preach the gospel to all the nations, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The disciples, every time somebody got saved, they baptized them, right? And they baptized them in the name of Jesus, by the way. I don't know if y'all noticed that. They baptized them in the name of Jesus, right? They recognized the name on earth that is above every name, the name Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is Jesus, right? I'm not a Unitarian for anybody out there that wants to accuse me. I'm not that. But so when I baptize you guys out here, who has been baptized by me here, right? Don, John, Dorothy, Sarah, many of you here have been baptized by me. Casey, Sandy, all right? We've baptized over 7 dozen people in the last 3 years down here. Yeah, clap for that. If you take the opportunity today to take part with us and be baptized today, the way that I will do it is I'm going to ask you, have you put your faith, have you made a confession of faith in Jesus Christ and the price that he paid for you to be redeemed and reconciled to him? And if your answer is yes, I'm not going to ask you to renounce Satan. I'm not going to go through all that. You've made a confession of faith in Christ Jesus, and I'm going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen? Right? Because I believe that that's biblically, that covers all the bases. Right? Okay. All right. So, anybody else? Before we have got shorts, we have got shirts, we've got towels, we got everything that you need if you want to join us today and take this next step in being baptized into Christ in the family of Christ. Amen? Amen? So, anybody else? Yes, sir. Sir? Amen. Praise God, bro. Praise God. Amen? Hey, brother. How you doing? Say again. You can be. So, brother said, you can be baptized and come out the same person. Yeah. You could just be taking a bath, right? Just, right. But what are the three things? Repent. And the repentance is the key here, right? That doesn't mean you're coming perfect, because you're not. None of us do, and we're none of us are ever going to be perfect. It's making a faith decision that he has paid the price for my sin, and I want to return to him. I want to follow after him. I want to know you more. I want to know you better. I want you to help me be what I was always supposed to be. Amen? Those things tied together, plus his spirit living inside us that gives us the power and the continued determination to be able to start to walk this thing out. And walking this thing out doesn't mean that you're going to start, like, living a perfect life and you're never going to cuss, you're never going to get mad, you're never going to get angry. What should manifest itself in you? What should number one manifest itself in you is that you should start loving people more. That should be like the automatic thing, is you start to just look at people in a different way, right? That your heart just turns for God's kids, right? And you realize, hey, that ain't just a dude sitting next to me. That's my brother, man. That's my sister. And so our love and our compassion towards people is the first thing that's going to well up inside you, right? Because that's what God is. He's love. And when he starts to live in us, go ahead, brother. Look, the Bible has two doctrines, and I don't want to get way too deep, because we'll talk about all this stuff over time. But it says we're justified by Christ and we're sanctified in the Spirit, right? So the justification, you're being adopted into the family of God, is instantaneous based on your faith. Amen? Sanctification is a lifelong process that will never end until this flesh is gone completely, till we're outside of this, till we leave this body and we are in his presence. Amen? Right? So the process of of walking in His goodness and His grace and continuing to operate in what the Bible calls the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, kindness, peace, long-suffering, all of that, that's an everyday process. And it's a relational process, not a works process. It's not like I'm going to make myself a list and I'm going to start doing all these things right. No, there's only one thing on the list. I'm going to get up in the morning and I'm going to say, good morning, Jesus. What are we doing today? How can I get closer to you? How can I know you better? Right? That's the only thing that's on your list every day for the rest of your life is how can I get closer to you? Because if I'm trying to get closer to Him, the rest of the stuff is going to manifest itself out. If I am wanting to look like Him and be like Him, then everything else that I think is important to do or not to do is going to happen automatically based on the relationship I have with Him. Amen? Hi, Karina. Did you get a place? No? Okay. Somebody told me that you weren't living down there anymore. On the 13th? Good, good. You getting baptized today? Hey, we got everything for you. We'll help you. We'll do whatever. Yeah, talk to her guys and find out what she needs there. What were you saying, brother? Yeah. Yeah. So prayer is the process by which God begins to mold you into His image, right? Is that? Yeah. Oh, okay, so listen to this. She's saying prayer is the relationship that begins to mold you, right? So we are in communion with Christ, right? We are in community with each other. And the common root word there, commune, is the same common word that communication starts with. The way that we build relationship with each other and the way that we build relationship with God is by communicating with Him, and we call that communication prayer. And it is the best and only way. God communicated to us. Right here. This is His best and biggest form of communication. Beyond this, our conversations that we have with Him daily to tell us what this means and more about who He is, that is what builds relationships. So that is perfect, sister. That is perfect. All right. So we ready to play some music and for some folks to get baptized? You ready? Amen. Okay. So we are already ready over here. Everybody that is that wants to get baptized today, if you come up and meet with us, we'll start to get you into a place where you can get changed into some shorts and shirts. You keep the shorts and shirts, right? Give us the towel back. Towels are expensive. What's up? Huh? Oh, sorry. Yes, you guys know Dan and Viv out here. Viv is the blonde lady that works at the coffee table most weeks, right? Very sweet, always accommodating, and they're out here all the time, her and her fiance Dan, the older gentleman that's out here with us. They are getting married today at 2:00, right? They're both in their 70s, I guess. They're old. They're old. Yeah, I'm gonna tell them that later when I see them. Y'all are old. But not too old to get married, right? They're both widowers, and y'all pray for them. But we want to celebrate them because they are out here all the time and have been for a very long time. Been doing this with us for well over 2 years, so almost from the beginning, and so we're so happy for them that they're together. And Lisa's still shaking her head because I said they're old. The Bible says, "Speak the truth in love." They're old.
Oh, Barry. And Barry is Dan's good friend, and he had always come out here with us a lot. He broke his ankle badly and hasn't been out here for a few months, but I'm going to get to see him today, too, and he's going to be back out here in September, he said. So we're looking forward to that.